morning, Life Spring. We are so happy you're here. Let's get up on our feet. Let's get to worship together this morning. We are so excited you're here with us.
Song we could ever sing. breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath. There is no one like you, there is none beside.
Come on, let's sing, I Will Build.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be one more time. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
I love that part of that song because it's such a like a declaration, and like, this is what I'm gonna do. And when times are hard, this is what I'm still gonna do. I'm still gonna put my trust in my Jesus, and I'm still gonna put my faith in him because he is faithful. Amen. And my biggest prayer lately has been, God, just show yourself. Show who you are, just like that song says, show us who you are. And I read a scripture this past week, and I wanna share it with you this morning. It says, listen to the Lord who created you. The one who formed you says, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by my name, and you are mine. When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. You will walk through the fire of oppression, but you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. And when I read that scripture, I thought, thank you, Lord, because you're showing me still that you are faithful and that you are present in these times, and you're still moving, and you're still shifting things, even though it doesn't seem like it, but he is. And so as we go into this next song, it's a powerful one. I want us to think about what the Lord is doing and think about what he's doing, not what we're seeing, but what he's doing. Amen? Because there's a difference. So, Father, we give you all our praise. We give you all our worship. Father, we thank you that just like the scripture says, you have ransomed us. You have taken us, Father. We're no longer up for adoption, Father, but you've taken us in, Father, and we are your children. We thank you and we worship you, Father.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. worship you. You are here, turning lights around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship.
That is who you are. That is who.
is who you are. That is who you are.
How many of you believe that? How many of you believe that? Keep playing in the background. That's beautiful. How many of you believe that is who he is? He's a miracle worker. He's a way maker. When it seems like there's no way, when it seems like there's a storm, he has a way to get you through the storm or over the storm. As we remain standing in his presence this morning, I want us to pray. How many of you know prayer changes things? How many of you believe that we can see a change in this nation, in our nation? I believe it. And I believe if my people, the scripture says, will humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways and seek my face and pray, then will I hear from heaven and I will heal their land. How many of you know we need healing in our land? This is what I believe is happening. We've taught on this and we know this. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but it's a spiritual war out there. And hell has unleashed, at first, a spirit of fear all over America. And that was quite a storm. And there's some people that are still suffering from a spirit of fear. But at LifeSpring, we've been praying for our people. We've been praying for our nation. We pray out the spirit of fear. We pray against the spirit of fear. And we pray in Psalm 91, which says, no plague shall come upon your dwelling. And so far, to my knowledge, not one person at this church has got COVID, and we want to keep it that way. Amen. And then it's like another storm was released over America, and it was a spirit of hatred that came from hell. Can I tell you this morning that racism comes from the pit of hell? Racism that has no place. In fact, in heaven, the Bible says every nation, every tribe, every tongue. And there's going to be all colors, all kinds, all cultures in heaven. And that's the way we like it here at LifeSpring Church. All cultures, all colors are welcome here at LifeSpring Church. And we love you just as much if you're black, white, brown. It doesn't matter what color or what race you are. Amen. We welcome you and we love you, and you're a part of our family. And I see another, right now we're in that storm. I see another storm being unleashed from hell that's coming, and it's a spirit of greed. You watch, there'll be a spirit of greed come over this nation, and it'll be a storm. But here's the deal. When Jesus faced a storm, he did two things. In one story, he rebuked the storm and said, peace be still, and the storm died. So we have the power through Jesus Christ this morning to rebuke the storms over our nation. And then also in another story where there was a storm, he went walking on top of it. And he said, hey, Peter, come on, I'll teach you how to do this. Let me teach you. Walk with me, and you can walk on top of this storm. How many of you know these storms that are being unleashed on our nation, we need to walk on top of them and rebuke them in the name of Jesus. So will you join me in prayer as we want a spirit of love to shine through this church. The Holy Spirit to shine through. Let his light shine through us. Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name for the fact that we live in the greatest nation in the world. We thank you for our freedom. We thank you for all of our soldiers and veterans, and some have laid down their lives so that we could enjoy the freedom. God, we can't thank you enough for that, Lord. But we also thank you that your word says that we are in a war. And it's an invisible war. It's a war that not a lot of people realize, but it's a war against demonic spirits. And right now, through the authority of Jesus Christ, we bind every demonic spirit that's been unleashed over our nation. And in Jesus' name, we say, be gone, spirit of fear. We say, be gone, spirit of hatred. We say, be gone, spirit of greed, in Jesus' name. And we fight as soldiers. Like the Apostle Paul taught us, we stand, and we fight, and we put on our spiritual armor. And we thank you, Lord, for the ability through you to bind up the strong man and kick him out of our house. And we do that in Jesus' name. And we thank you that you are a way maker. And just like we just sang, you're always working. You're always working. And I believe you're up in heaven right now, working on the next greatest revival that's about to hit and sweep this nation that we've never even seen before. As these demonic spirits leave in Jesus' name, and as love and your light shines through our churches and our nation and our country, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Hey, let's give God some praise this morning. Just welcome somebody. You can air high five them or bump them or whatever you want to do. You may be seated this morning. We are so thankful you are here. We are so glad to see each and every one of you. Many of you are watching on Facebook Live and on YouTube and all of that stuff, and we welcome you also. We ask you and invite you to be a part of our family. And the way to do that, the best way to do that, is to text the word welcome to this number, 972-402-6456. Let me say it again in case you're watching on Facebook. Text the word welcome, if it's your first visit, to 972-402-6456. If you're not getting my emails, my blog every week, if you've moved and you've changed addresses, just go ahead and text the word welcome. You'll get a message that says welcome to Life Spring Church, but we know who you are. Just text that to 972-402-6456, and we invite you to get connected to a great church. Amen? And also, we have a lot of exciting stuff. Now, here's something that we cannot do online. I suppose there's nothing that God cannot do, but we can't baptize you online, okay? We could try. We could do a virtual, I guess, fill up your bathtub, and we could try, you know, to do that. But we're going to have a baptism right here at this church in 2 weeks. Everybody say 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
So June 28th. Listen, we have a beautiful lady right back here. Vicky, give everybody a wave right there. Vicky, let her know that I want to get baptized. Come on, church. We're not Presbyterians. Give God some praise up in the house. I'm just kidding. If you're watching and you're Presbyterian, we love you too. But we clap and we get excited around here. But Vicky will take your name and put you down for baptism. You don't even have to be a member of our church to get baptized. All you have to do is have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So we want to do that in 2 weeks. Hey, next week is Father's Day. Did you know that? Some of you do, some of you don't. But in case you didn't know, next week is Father's Day. So if you just had an uh-oh moment, I've got to go get a Father's Day gift, then good for you. But we have got a very special speaker. My dad, Father, he has so much wisdom, over 65 years in ministry. How many of you know you can learn something through that? And I can't wait to hear his wisdom next week on Father's Day. Also, we're going to present four of our great men with swords that have gone through our men's program. And so if you're, give them some praise. So if you're out there and you've been through that program and you have your sword, please bring it next week, because we're going to make that tunnel as the new guys get welcomed in to being the men of our church, ready to serve and ready to fight spiritually. Amen. So we are excited about that. That's what's coming up in our church. We've got a great summer plan. I can't wait to introduce my new series to you, Overcoming Obstacles. It has everything to do with this COVID and all the spirits that have been unleashed on our country. And we're gonna learn how we overcome all that. Amen. Through Jesus Christ. And so that's starting June 28th. But I want to go to the Lord in prayer. And before I do, I just want to say thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Many of you work hard and you give your tithe and offering to this church so that we can carry out the vision to everyone. And Amy and I can't thank you enough. I mean, it means so much. We hear of churches that have experienced, they're in real trouble right now. But you know what? God's taken care of Life Spring Church. And you know how he's doing it? He's blessing you guys that are faithful. Thank you so much. We can't thank you enough. And some of you are getting blessed like crazy. And you'll hear some testimonies coming up over the next few weeks of people that are just getting experiencing God's blessing. But anyway, I want to pray for you. We have a bucket in the back, a bucket up front if you're here today, or there's other ways to give. You can mail it in to P.O. Box 886, Rockwall, Texas 75087. You can also text it in. You can text the word give to that same phone number, 972-402-6456. Text the word give, and you can process your payment that way. So there's many ways to give to God's vision. Father, we're just so thankful today for who you are, for what you've done. And like the song says, you're always working. I thank you that we don't serve a lazy God. We serve a God who loves his people so much that you're preparing something in heaven that we can't even imagine, that we can't even wrap our thoughts around. That's so fantastic, God, and I thank you for that. And it's coming. We just need to pray it down, and we need to catch it when it comes down out of heaven. God, we thank you for that. We praise you for that. I thank you for your blessing on your people today. And we continue to pray Psalm 91 over our people. No plague, including COVID-19, including any coronavirus, including anything like that. No plague shall come upon your dwelling. And we speak that, we believe that, and we proclaim that over your people today. We thank you for it, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
What are angels?
Angels help us and they're in our hearts. The angels are right here and Jesus is in the middle.
Where does Jesus live?
Right there.
Right where?
Right there.
On the floor?
Uh-huh.
Some of the Ten Commandments are?
Do not punch, do not lie, do not kick, do not spit.
What do you think God looks like?
So tall.
Oh, and can you explain sanctification? Hey, what does God do all day?
He stays in our house all day.
How old is God?
100.
Can you tell me how old you think God is?
3.
Why did they eat an apple?
Because they wanted to eat something to eat.
How many commandments are in the Ten Commandments? How many numbers?
Uh-huh.
You know what happened to Adam and Eve?
They ate a snake.
You want to tell me the story of Samson?
He died. Somebody cut his hair and he wasn't strong anymore.
Why did his hair give him strength?
Because he was big like a grown-up.
How did Moses get the Ten Commandments?
He worked up a really tall island.
I have a toy beak and I have a toy bell.
Is that story in the Bible?
Yeah.
What book of the Bible is that story in?
A princess on it.
Do you know the story about Adam and Eve?
They died. Because they were super, 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 super old.
Alright. Out of the mouth of babes. Amen. We are blessed today. Who's ready to hear a great message? All right. Get ready. We are blessed today to have a man who has many life experiences, been through a lot. He's an attorney in Memphis, Tennessee. Give a big, warm welcome to Randy Songstead. Randy Songstead. How'd y'all like?
Good morning. Glad to be with everyone here today. It's the first time in 16 years I've been in a pulpit preaching. Spoke a few times, but we'll see if we get through it. Today we're going to look at a passage of scripture in Mark chapter 5, starting with verse 25, and it's a passage of scripture that hasn't been preached very often because of the very nature of the miracle that surrounds it. And the story is about the hemorrhaging woman. Back in the old days, they called it the woman with the issue of blood. And this woman living in Israel had a condition where her menstrual cycle never stopped. Now you say, do we really have to hear that on Sunday morning? Well, it's in the Bible, and we're going to go through and tell you why. It's a very important passage because there are very few stories in the Gospels regarding women, because women were nothing but property back in ancient Israel. And so for Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three of those synoptic gospels, to record this story, there is special significance behind what went on. And so this woman, Mark says in chapter 5, verse 25, says, a woman, and I'm reading from the NLT, New Living Translation, a woman in the crowd had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding. And it's important to know that Moses, the law of Moses, specifically addressed this condition. And because this woman was living in the Old Testament, the end of the Old Testament, she was subject to the rules and the regulations of the law of Moses. And so if you flip with me to Leviticus chapter 15, now I'm not going to read all of this because it gets pretty lengthy. In fact, I've always said if you have insomnia, the best thing you can do is break out Leviticus and start at chapter 1. You'll be asleep by chapter 3. And so Moses in the law in verse 19 says, whenever a woman has her menstrual period, she will be ceremonially unclean for 7 days. And then he goes on and talks about everywhere she walks, everywhere she sits, anything she does, everywhere she goes, she's ceremonially unclean. And when you, then he goes on to say, and if it does, if her menstrual cycle doesn't stop, and it is perpetual in nature, she is ceremonially unclean forever. I mean, until it stops. And so when this woman is having this problem, this issue, she didn't ask for it. Mark says that it came upon her 12 years before. And she'd suffered with it every day for 12 years. She couldn't, according to the law of Moses, and I'll leave it for you to read later on that whole big passage. But he says, you can't make sacrifice. You can't come into the tabernacle. You can't come into the temple. You can't be a part of the people of God and the people of Israel. You are treated as a leper, and you can go no further. Let's look at some historical context behind this. Because a woman with this health condition, she was obviously anemic. In the days 2,000 years ago, they didn't know anything about diet. You were lucky if you had a flatbread, what we would call a flatbread, that was cooked over coals once a day, maybe a little olive oil on it, maybe a little olive here or a fig there. If you got lucky, maybe a little fish. But that was the ancient diet. And so she wasn't schooled in, you know, I need to take an iron supplement. They didn't exist. I need to eat some liver. They didn't know. And so she would have been in a extremely weakened position, condition, for having this go on for 12 years. Knowing not only is she physically debilitated, but she is spiritually debilitated. She can't get to her God. It's as though the God has rejected her. The one God that she so desperately wants to worship, but she can't worship. Because there's a barrier between her and her God. She didn't ask for it. It's something that had come upon her, evidently suddenly. And so, in verse 26, Mark gives us even more detail. He says she had suffered a great deal from many doctors. And over the years, she had spent everything she had to pay them. But she had gotten no better. In fact, she had only gotten worse. A couple of things about that passage that stands out. Number one, she had money at some point in time. So no doubt she was a widow. Women basically weren't allowed to have money back in the day unless their husband gave it to them, maybe through an inheritance or what have you. But she had money at one point. Now she has none. She had gone to doctors and physicians, and frankly, in the ancient world, they were no more than barbaric experimentalists. They experimented on people to see if certain things would work. Now, I'm not going to get overly graphic about this, but several years ago when I was at the British Museum, we were going through the history of ancient medicine. And they had dental tools, dental utensils, forceps, you know, all the things, a lot that we still have today. And at the time of Christ, they had what we would call a Foley catheter that was made out of iron. And the ancient physicians would treat people with, I'm going to call it a Foley catheter, an ancient Foley catheter. And so they learned on the battlefields when soldiers were slashing each other up with swords and stabbing each other with spears, that when a man was bleeding on the battlefield, they could take a hot iron, put it in a fire, and sear the wound, and the bleeding would stop. That's all they knew of how to stop bleeding. So when this woman goes to physicians, in Mark's gospel says, she had suffered a great deal from many doctors without drawing you any more pictures. I'll leave it to you to understand how horrible and how barbaric her treatments were. It says she spent all of her money on them, but she continuously got worse. She had gotten to such a state that she had to be mentally fatigued, desperate. If she were to see a psychologist at that point in time, they said, well, darling, you're suffering from depression. In fact, you've got probably an anxiety disorder, or this disorder and that disorder, because I don't have any money. I don't know what I'm going to be able to do with my life. Who's going to take care of me? My husband's died. I can't get around because I'm weak. I can't be around the people of Israel. And there was nothing in her life that gave her hope. She was in a state of hopelessness. Sometimes the worst things that happen in your life is when you can't find a way out and you can't see a way out. When suddenly you start looking at your bank account and you've got no money in the pipeline and you're thinking, what am I going to do next month? What am I going to do next week? When the doctor comes and he gives you a diagnosis and it says it's chronic, it's never going to go away, you're going to have to live with this. That hopelessness affects you in several ways, many ways. And sometimes that, in and of itself, is worse than the affliction is. This is where this woman was. She had no money. She had no hope for her spiritual condition. She had no hope for her physical condition. She's losing it. And then in Mark 27 and 28, the first ray of hope has come into her life. Mark says she had heard about Jesus. So she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his robe, for she thought to herself, if I can just touch his robe, I'll be healed. Now, there's certain things that are very important about that passage and the history behind that passage. The ancient Israelite men, it was a command of Moses that every man in Israel wear an outer garment. And that outer garment would be tied together with a blue and white cord with tassels that hung down to the ground. Jesus, in fact, rebukes the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and he said, you wear your phylacteries too large and your tassels too long, because both were a symbol of how spiritual you were, and it was the reminder that you are obedient to the law. And so you picture this, and frankly, it's pretty humorous. Back in Jesus' day, you would see Pharisees walking with these long tassels on the four corners of their garment, and they would have a box, a wooden box, tied to their head, and they would have a little door, and they'd write a scripture down, and open the door, put the scripture in their little helmet, and shut the door, and they would walk around, because the law of Moses said, This law shall be in your hearts and in your minds. And so for the Pharisee, I want to show everybody how much the law means to me, and so I'm going to get a bigger box. We probably had the Pharisees walking around, couldn't keep their head up because their phylacteries were too large. Probably needed a chiropractor at the time. And so Jesus scolds them because they're trying to show how spiritual they are. Now, if you go to Numbers chapter 15, this is where this comes in. Moses writes and he says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, give the following instructions to the people of Israel. Throughout the generations to come, you must make tassels for the hems of your clothing and attach them with a blue cord. When you see the tassels, you will remember and obey all the commands of the Lord instead of following your own desires and defiling yourselves as you are prone to do. The tassels will help you remember that you must obey all my commands and be holy to your God. I'm the Lord God that brought you out of Egypt." So the whole purpose of a tassel hanging off the robe was to remind you of the law and your obedience to the law. Well, when this woman sees this, she focuses in. Matthew's gospel specifically says she focused in on the tassel, and he uses the Greek word prospedu, which means the tassel. And so when she sees Jesus from afar, you've got to think for a moment. Number one, she's weak. She's debilitated. Crowds are pressing in around him. And as they're pressing in around him, she is trying to get to him. She's probably crawling on the ground to get between people in order to get to Christ. And suddenly, as she starts getting closer, she sees the tassel. And in Matthew's gospel, he uses the perfect tense in the Greek, which is interpreted, "All I have to do," she kept saying it over and over within herself, "all I have to do is touch that tassel. All I've got to do is touch the tassel. All I've got to do is touch the tassel." She was determined. Something inside her, faith, was sparked to think that all I've got to do is touch the tassel. The reminder of what stands against me. Why would I want to touch that tassel? But she is determined that that is all she has to do. I don't have to have Jesus lay his hands on me. I don't have to have him touch me. All I've got to do is just touch his tassel. And she fights and she gets up closer and closer. And no doubt, if you were to see it cinematically, it was probably very dramatic because he's just out of reach. He's just out of reach. And suddenly, at the last minute, she reaches out and she grabs a hold of the tassel and bam! It's like electricity shoots through her body and she immediately knows that she's been healed. And the Bible says, and immediately her fountain was dried up. The Bible says immediately the bleeding stopped. And she could feel in her body that she had been healed from her terrible condition. When she was healed by this condition, it's interesting because in the Greek text, and when I'm using the Greek text, if you don't know, the Bible originally was written in Greek. And they took that Greek text, and they found some of the oldest Greek texts dating back to the 2nd century. And that's basically what your NIV, NLT, is based upon, is those old texts called Codex Sinaiticanus and Codex Alexandrinus. And so there are three words in the Greek that mean healing. The first is ieomai. And ieomai is a word that they used for a cure, slowly curing a condition. Today, if you were to have cancer, God forbid, and you went in for chemo and you went through 25 rounds of chemo, eventually you get a clean bill of health at the end, you have been ieomai'd. Over a period of time, you've been cured. The second word, and the most popular word that infiltrates our language, is therapeuo, where we get therapeutic healing, where you go see someone, they work with you, and in a shorter time frame, you are healed. Therapeuo, therapist, the therapeutic healing, that sort of thing is where we get it. But none of those are the words that they use in Scripture. In fact, all three Gospels that report this event, they don't use any one of those words. Matthew uses ieomai to say the doctors that she went to see could never ieomai her, could never cure her. And so the word that's used throughout Matthew, Mark, and Luke is she kept saying within herself, if I can touch that tassel, I will be sozo. The word sozo is interpreted, I shall be saved. And all of the text when she says, and she immediately received her sozo, her healing, soste, within her body she was healed. It's letting you know that not only was she healed physically, but her physical healing was tied directly to her spiritual healing. She couldn't get to God because of that condition. She couldn't make sacrifice because of that condition. Now, she has not only been healed physically, but she's been saved spiritually. The Bible goes on here in Mark. Let me get my notes square away. And in verse 30 to 34, it says, Jesus realized at once that healing power had gone out of him. So he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my robe? His disciples said to him, look at the crowd pressing around you. How can you ask who touched me? He said, but he kept on looking around to see who had done it. Then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell to her knees in front of him and told him what she had done. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Your suffering is over. And you can picture this in Scripture, cinematically speaking, where Jesus feels a jolt go out of him. And he looks around and people are trying to touch him. They're trying to talk to him. And he says, who touched me? And the disciples are looking around like, have you lost your mind? Everybody's touching you. He said, no, 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 no. This is the Randy paraphrase version. No, no, no. Somebody with faith has touched me because I felt dunamis power go out of my body. Dunamis is the Greek word that we have for dynamite. It's the explosive kind of power. It's that power that went out of his body into this woman, and she was instantly healed because of her faith. You say, you know, Randy, that's a nice story. But what in the world does that have to do with where I'm at right now? I've lost my job because of all this COVID. I've got, I don't know where my next check's going to come from. I don't know what's going to happen to me. Maybe you have something, a chronic pain. We all have a barrier just like this woman had. She's trying to get past something that you just can't seem to get past. And it may be something that is absolutely making you lose your mind because of the pressures that are coming around you from day in and day out. And you go, I don't know how I'm going to make it another day. I can't go on. The stress from money, from finances, from health, from chronic pain, from loneliness, from depression, from whatever it is, we've all got a barrier. And the message for us today from this little story from 2,000 years ago is that we all have a barrier. And as long as you focus on your barrier, it's going to stay a barrier. But when you come to the realization that your barrier is wrapped around the waist of the I am, suddenly you're going to see a difference. When you begin to realize that your barrier is wrapped around the waist of the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the firstborn from among the dead, the Messiah of Yahweh, the bright and the morning star, this is the one who your problem is wrapped around. And Colossians says, it pleased God to make Jesus Christ preeminent over all things and over everything in heaven and in earth. He's over all of it. So why do you look at your barrier when your barrier is wrapped around the waist of the Redeemer? That is every single person in this life. You go through something. You have to. It all, sometimes you feel like, I don't understand. I didn't deserve this. This is not what I should be going through. But you go through it anyway. When you realize that Christ is the one that your problem is wrapped around, your situation is going to change. It can't help but change. It's going to change because you've given it to him. This is why 1 Peter 5:7 in the original Greek says, casting all your anxieties on him Why? Because he cares deeply for you. That's all I have. I'm going to give it to Amy, and she's going to lead us in a hymn. Rick, you're up.
Thank you, Randy. Now, we just can't leave it right there, can we? After that great message, we got to put God's word into action. So what I want to do, let's all stand to our feet. Randy requested this song, and you all know this song. You sang it in Sunday school. It's kind of an old Sunday school hymn, basically. And so as we sing this song, which is called Oh How I Love Jesus, I want to just invite you, because chances are just about everybody in here is facing a barrier of one kind or the other. Maybe you need healing today. Maybe you need healing in your marriage today. Maybe you need healing in your finance today. See what he beautifully pointed out, that word sozo, she was healed emotionally. Imagine how she felt of 12 years of rejection. Some of you have experienced rejection in your life, and you're suffering from that barrier, and you need healing over that. She had experienced physical problems. She had experienced financial problems. But when Jesus said, your faith has made you whole, I love that word whole. Not just, I'm just going to heal you physically. That would be a fractional healing. Not just, I'm going to heal you spiritually, but you're whole. You're going to be healed emotionally, spiritually, financially. I believe her finances were restored immediately as well. That's what the word says. Some of you need that in your life. Now listen, don't let pride hold you back from a miracle. If you need prayer today, that's why we come to church. That's why we're here. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, we're going to pray for you as well. And in front of your children, in front of your spouse, in front of your whoever you're watching with, if you're watching by yourself, in front of God, if you need healing of some kind today, just raise your hand up in front of God, in front of your friends, in front of your family. Come on. Look at all of the people that need healing. Now, as we sing this song, everyone with your hand up, I'm going to invite you to sing along. Everybody sing along. But step out of your comfort zone. Every single person in the Bible, God asked them, step one, step out in faith. You know that one, you know who didn't get healed in that story? All the people just standing around watching. There was probably lepers. There was probably people who had all kinds of problems. But one woman stepped out of her comfort zone and said, I've tried everything else. I need Jesus today. One woman. And so I'm going to invite you to step out and receive from God and receive your healing, receive your miracle. Come on, let's sing it together. Let's step out and come forward as a step of faith. Oh. That's beautiful. I'm going to pray over everyone that came forward. Father, I thank you for people who are bold and willing to step out of the tent, to step out of the comfort zone, to step out of the bubble, and to say no to pride, no to fear, no to I don't care what people think. I need Jesus right now in this moment. I need God. I need a touch from God right now in this moment. And God, there are people up here that need your healing touch. So, Father, we thank you that you've been preparing and preparing and preparing in heaven to release a healing touch. God, we believe you healed in the Old Testament, you healed in the New Testament, and you are still healing today, because you are the Lord our God, who was, who is, and who is to come. You are the Lord our healer. And God, we ask for miracles, Lord, whether it be financial healing. Lord, release a miracle over your people. Whether it be emotional healing, Lord, release a miracle over your people. Whether it be spiritual healing, Lord, release a miracle over your people. Whether it be mental healing, Lord, release a miracle over your people. God, whether it be physical healing, Lord, release a miracle over your people. God, there's people here today, I believe, that their marriage needs healing. God, in Jesus' name, we bind in the love towards the husband and the wife. Lord, we pray for healing in the marriage, healing in the family. Lord, for those that have fractured relationships with their kids, we bind in healing between the parent and the child, or the grandparent and the child. God, we speak healing. We speak your word. Sozo, in Jesus' name, we ask for a release of healing all over your people today. We thank you, God, that we have a God that we can have a relationship. We have a God that you care so much about your people, that you said, I'm going to do something about that. I'm going to allow part of me to be made manifest in the flesh on this earth. My son, I'm going to send to this earth, and he's going to be rejected and despised and put on a cross and crucified, but I'm going to allow him to shed his blood to cover the sins and the needs of the people. And not only does that blood cleanse us from all unrighteousness, not only if we say yes to the Lord, the Lord is offering right now salvation. The Lord is offering salvation, but we have to receive it. Something can be offered and we may reject it, but when we receive it and say, yes, I want to belong to that. I want to belong to Jesus. I want to belong to that healing right now in Jesus' name. We say yes to that. And we thank you, God, for sending your son to die on the cross. And he bled for our sins, but he also bled for our healing, because the scripture says, by the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. So we thank you, Lord, for healing over your people today. Healing over our land today. God, we thank you for that. And Lord, we thank you that our God didn't just stay in the grave. That we could go to Jerusalem today and go into the tomb of Jesus, and there's nothing there. Because on the third day, we thank you, God, that historically it was documented that Jesus rose again and was resurrected, so that the whole world can know that our God has power over the grave. Our God has power over everything, and anything that we need, we can call upon the name of the Lord, Romans says, and we shall be saved. So God, we call upon your name. We thank you for your salvation. We thank you for the wonderful people that are here today and watching on social media today, and we give you glory, we give you honor. We thank you for the wonderful word, and Lord, we believe for the next weeks to come, we're going to hear miracle testimonies of how God touched us, how God changed our life, how God changed our marriage, how God changed our finance, how God changed our physical condition, how God changed our mental condition, how God changed our spiritual condition. We thank you for that, and we praise you for that. We give you glory. Come on, church, if you agree with me today, just give God a big hand of praise. Man, thank you, Lord. I don't know about you, but I just want to go out there and kick the devil in the butt. God bless you today. Y'all have a great one. And we love you. We'll see you next week for Father's Day.
is crowned with glory. Is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. Shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise. Now